Communication is often one of the most challenging things a parent has to deal with in the teen years. A new book shares insights on the mindsets and motivations of young people and strategies on how to relate to them.
10 to 25, the science of motivating young people, a groundbreaking approach to leading the next generation and making your own life easier, is written by David Yeager, who's a developmental psychologist and professor at the University of Texas at Austin. Thanks for being with us.
Yeah, thanks
Good
for
morning.
Having me.
I think every generation comes along and everyone's like, not motivated. Well, they're not like we were. I mean, is it any different now for this generation?
I mean, people have been saying that back to the ancient Greeks, but it is true that technology changes the very details of how we interact with them, but the fundamentals of the human brain haven't changed over hundreds of thousands of years. And once you know what motivates them, then actually you can do a lot better.
I actually wondered if biologically adolescence is moving up for us, and does that change the equation at all, especially with social media and kids encountering it younger and younger?
Yeah, a lot of people don't know this, but we think of adolescence starting around age 10, the onset of puberty, but lasting off until the mid to late 20s, because it's got a biological onset and a social offset. So that's adopting an adult-like role. And we like to blame young people for failure to launch or living with your parents, but to be honest, the economy is so complex, you need so much training to make a difference that you kind of matter later and later. So you're in that period where you're ready to contribute, but not yet allowed to for a longer period than any time in our human history.
So you have some tips for how parents should maybe try and motivate their kids. And I like this term you use called a compliment sandwich, which you say is a terrible thing to do.
Oh my goodness.
Talk about what that is.
Well, no one wants to eat it, that's for sure. So the compliment sandwich is when I say, you know, I love your enthusiasm. All of your work was terrible and has to change, but thanks for showing up on time. Right? And it's not delicious.
So good thing at the start, bad thing in the middle, good thing at the end.
Yeah.
And it just doesn't work.
Not good.
Well, it's like you're doing mental math. Like, it was a net positive. But young people aren't asking themselves, does this adult think that I'm enthusiastic? They're asking themselves, does this person with power over my outcomes think I'm incompetent and no good? And if you don't address that question, they're not open to feedback.
But if I'm just then reduced to explaining it to them, is that a good strategy? Because that seems like they're going to see that as being condescending.
Well, like another pitfall parents fall into is something I call groan-splaining, right? Just the idea of if only I explain it to them for a long enough period of time, then they'll come around. And what we find is that taking young people seriously, saying, look, we've got high standards, but the reason I'm holding you to them is because I believe that with the right support, you can meet them. And I wouldn't be doing that if I didn't think you had a lot of potential. That works a lot better.
You also say that parents either fall into this, you're either the enforcer or the protector, but you say you shouldn't be doing either of those things exclusively. You should be more of a motivator.
Yeah, it's a big dilemma for parents. It feels like on the one hand, you can be an authoritarian dictator, but your way or the highway, but there are gonna be a lot of tears and frustration, or you could be a kind, friendly, like pushover, right, with no standards. And what we find is that what's most effective is to do both. That you don't have to either only enforce the standard or protect them from distress. You can be what I call a mentor. Very high standards, it's tough, but very high support so they can meet those standards.
Yeah, talk about the role of storytelling when it comes to parenting.
Yeah, well, so a lot of kids are starting school right now, or they might be leaving school, starting a job, and that's gonna raise difficulty for young people, and they're gonna wanna tell the story of, this is so hard that it means I don't belong, I can't do it, I'm a failure, et cetera. And so as a parent, and also as a boss, as a teacher, we have to give young people better stories. For instance, that difficulties now are normal, they tend to improve, but there are things that you can do right now to get on that journey of growing and improving over time.
So you don't, when you say storytelling, should you relay a story from this happened to me in my past? Is that what you mean? That's similar to what you're going through?
Well, I mean, you know, young people, you could think of them as evolution's perfectly designed hypocrisy detectors. So like if they care about who the messenger is. Yeah. If you're telling a story that's not from an authentic place, it won't work. But yeah, if a parent has that story, great. But what a lot of people do is they say, look, I talked to someone who was in your position, here's the story that they had, or let's go talk to them. And you want the young person to carry that story with them as they face future difficulty.
Mm-hmm. All right. The book is 10 to 25, The Science of Motivating Young People, a groundbreaking approach to leading the next generation and making your own life easier. And you can see David September 9th at Evanston Township High School.
Good to see you. Thanks for being here.
Thanks for having me.
Hey, Mike.